The third historical force has been called the expanding circle. This is a concept that was named by Peter Singer, but first endorsed by Charles Darwin more than a century before. The idea is that evolution bequeathed us with a sense of empathy. Unfortunately, by default, we apply it only to a narrow circle of friends and family. But over the course of history, you can see the circle of empathy expanding to embrace not just the family, but the village, then the clan, then the tribe, then the nation, then it's extended to other races, to both sexes, to children, and eventually to other sentient beings, other species. This just begs the question of what expanded the circle, and as I hinted earlier, technologies that increase cosmopolitanism may have that effect. The growing appreciation of history, of literature, of media, of journalism, growing opportunities for travel. And we know from the social psychology laboratory that if you get a person to adopt the perspective of some other real or fictitious person, they are more sympathetic to that person, and they're more sympathetic to the category of people that that individual represents. Historical evidence includes the fact that in the 17th and 18th century, there was an expansion of literacy and travel, the so-called Republic of Letters, which preceded the humanitarian revolution. It may not be a coincidence that the second half of the 20th century, which had the long peace and the rights revolutions, was also the era of the electronic global village. And it's often been speculated that the rise of internet and social media has assisted the color revolutions and the Arab Spring. The final historical force I call the escalator of reason. The possibility that the growth of literacy, education, and public discourse has encouraged people to think more abstractly and more universally. Well, this raises the question of why violence has declined on so many scales of time and magnitude. And I'm going to suggest that the most likely possibility is that human nature is extraordinarily complex and has always comprised inclinations toward violence and inclinations that counteract them, what Abraham Lincoln called the better angels of our nature, and that historical circumstances have increasingly favored our peaceable inclinations. What are some of our motives for violence? Well, there's pure exploitation, the elimination of a human being that happens to be an obstacle on the path to something that you want, resulting in rape, plunder, conquest, and the elimination of rivals. There's dominance, the urge among individuals to climb the pecking order and become alpha male, or the corresponding urge among groups for ethnic, racial, national, or religious supremacy. And then there are ideologies, such as militant religions, nationalism, Nazism, and communism, that justify violence by their promise of a utopia. What do we have on the other side to counteract these motives for violence? What are our better angels? There's self-control, the ability to anticipate the consequences of behavior and inhibit violent impulses. There's empathy, the ability to feel others' pain. There's the moral sense, intuitions, some of which can increase violence, like tribalism, authority, and puritanism, but some of which, like a sense of fairness, can decrease violence. And then there's reason, the cognitive processes that allow us to engage in objective, detached analysis. A third possibility has been called the expanding circle. The idea is that evolution bequeathed us with a sense of empathy, but unfortunately, by default, we apply it only to a very narrow circle of allies, close friends, and family, and cute little babies and other warm, fuzzy things. But that over the course of history, this circle has expanded so that this emotion is now spread over the village, the clan, the tribe, the nation, other races, both sexes, children, and eventually other species. That begs the question of what expanded the circle, and I think the technologies of cosmopolitanism are a plausible cause. The consumption of history, literature, and journalism potentially get people into the habit of empathizing with others. And experiments have shown that if you have a person read the words or listen to the words of some other individual, they become more sympathetic, not just to that person, but to the category of people that that individual represents. The second half of the 20th century, which saw the long peace and the rights revolutions, were the era of the electronic global village. And though it's too early to say whether the color revolutions in the Arab Spring will have a happy ending, they certainly were fostered by the internet and social media. Finally, we have the escalator of reason, the possibility that the expansion of literacy, education, and public discourse encouraged people to think more abstractly and more universally.